the full presentation. Before we get started back with the rest of this, I did want to, when I first started this morning, I'm Rick Brown, to our guests and new people, and President. We have a nominating committee, Natalie Bright, Vicki Shane, and Kim Black. And some of them may be calling some of you over the next few months, so that we're already starting to work on our slate of officers for next year to replace those of us who are moving on. So please listen to what they call. The best way to have fun in this organization is to be involved. And working through the board has been great joy for me. I know Kim, most of you have done it, many of you have done it, and it's a great joy. So please welcome them when they call. And we did call the building and tell them it was getting a little chilly, so hopefully you heard the air on.
Thank you.
I appreciate
it.
We can hang in here.
You're fine. I couldn't hear you.
I'm going to quickly run through this little part right here, and then we'll get into how to add some text to your own fiction. So, just turn the page. Why readers love subtext, even if they don't know it. Okay. I know all of you in here are readers, I assume, if you're writers, although I did coach a person recently who said she wanted to write a book and asked me to coach her, and she doesn't read fiction, but she's writing a novel. I thought, this is going to be interesting. I can't convince her to read, so I don't know where this desire to write a novel comes from. Anyway, I know you're all readers in here, and I think when you're an astute reader that reads all the time, and you're reading for pleasure, you start to become a pro at body language and at prose and viewpoint and all of those things, and interpreting dialogue, and you don't want to sit passively back and have everything spelled out to you. I know I at least like figuring out what's going on in the story. That's part of it. I've read the movies a lot of times for my family. In fact, The Sixth Sense, when that came out, I went with my sister and her kids, and then my son Ryan and my son Jason. Well, I was sitting next to my son Ryan, and right after I always watch movies with my writer mind working. And I was sitting next to him, and right at the first of the movie, I leaned over and I said, he's dead. Ryan was in, I think it was in middle school, and he said, what? And I said, he's dead. He said, he is not. So, he's dead. So at the end of the movie, he was furious with me for ruining the movie for him. So from that point on, we had a rule at our house that you had to write down. If I always had to write it on a piece of paper.
That's how we do it, yeah.
And hold on to it. Just so I can prove to him I figured it out. That's how that works at my house. But astute readers, we don't want to sit back and have it all spelled out. We want, to figure it out. We enjoy interacting with the story and the characters and speculating and questioning and assuming. It makes the reading more interesting. It makes it more intellectually stimulating and entertaining. Now, does every novel have to have subtext? No. A lot of action-adventure novels and movies don't. I mean, think of the early James Bond movies. I don't think there was any subtext in those movies. He didn't have an inner life, He didn't fall in love or anything. He just, the woman got killed off and he just moved on to the next one. So, you don't have to have it. I mean, I don't think the Da Vinci Code had subtext in it. So a lot of stories that are more like action-adventure novels. I was going to say that men mainly read, but I'm not going to say that. don't have to have subtext and can be quite popular. The Da Vinci Code and the James Bond books and movies were very popular. But I think it's still you're writing a, and those are, you know, those are more plot-driven than character-driven type of fiction. But my personal opinion, if you're writing that type of fiction, if you do add subtext, you're just going to make it all the better. I think the new James Bond movies are so much better than the old ones because James Bond actually has emotions, as the old James Bond didn't. So I think it adds something to it. Now, if you're writing a character-driven book, you know, or a romance novel, or you definitely want to have subtext. So that, you know, you don't have to have it if you're writing especially action adventure and that sort of thing. But as writers, I think that we need to respect our readers' intelligence and know that we don't have to spell everything out. Most readers enjoy figuring that out for themselves. It's kind of like a painting. I used to be, when my kids were little in elementary school, we had a thing called Picture Lady that the PTA did. And every month a different mom or dad would go in with a famous painting, and we would all talk about what we see. And it was just amazing to me how we're all looking at the same thing, but all those kids brought something different to that, you know, and interpreted it differently. And it's the same way with fiction, you know, everybody, as we've just been talking about, brings something different to the story. So respect your readers' intelligence if they want to, you know, they can and they want to kind of try to guess and figure out and see which way the plot might be going and become co-creators with you. So how do we create subtext in our stories now that we know what it is? Whoops. A lot of this we've already discussed, and you should have, you know, gotten the idea of how, you know, creating characters within our lives. You need to accept that most characters have inner lives unless you're writing James Bond again. So accept that your characters have inner lives and that they have worries and conflicts and all that. By doing that and having them have an inner life, you make them so much more real to the reader. You know, have them have some internal conflicts, not just external obstacles that keep them from reaching their goal, but internal conflicts that keep them from reaching their goal. Foreshadow events that are going to come later in the story. Drop clues. That's how you foreshadow. Drop those clues like the Sixth Sense did. Sometimes you might want to have an unreliable narrator. I kind of get aggravated with when the main character is, I'm trying to think of the name of that book that was really popular. One that's coming to mind was The Girl on the Train had a very unreliable narrator, and readers either love that or hate it. You don't have to take it that far where the whole story is kind of built on the unreliable narrator. You can do it, you know, just things, small things within your story.
Gone Girl. Is that what you're
saying? That's the
Gone Girl.
That's always one of those.
Yes, Gone Girl was very aggravating to me. There was no one to like in that book. You know? So, but that seems to be kind of in vogue right now. So, but how can we go even deeper than these things we've already talked about to make sure that we do have subtext in our work, and also to make sure that once it's in there, your readers are going to know, are going to pick up on it, and are going to finally at some point figure out what's going on with your characters without you spelling it out. And one way is to actually, you know, this sounds basic, but consciously create it. The times when there's a writing teacher that I talk about a lot because I just think she's awesome. You guys need to look her up. She's got a lot of online things for writers. Her name's Alicia Rasley. And if you just Google her, you'll find all kinds of things.
How do you spell the last name?
Rasley.
Wow.
But she... I don't know where I was going with that. This is, it's not a, Anisha Rasley doesn't say this, but do look her up, she's great. K.M. Weiland states that even though readers don't know all the backstory of your characters and don't have to know it all. You need to know their backstory, okay? You have to have a clear understanding of what that subtext is. So really, you know, do some work before you start writing and figure out the lives of your characters, even that isn't going to be shown in the actual novel. That's going to make your character come across as all the more real. You're going to know their motivations, and so when you do put subtext in your book, the readers will pick up on that a little more easily. The times that I have I know where I was going with Alicia Rasley. I first learned about, you know, really got in depth about subtext with something that she taught. And when I took that, I had already published several novels, but when I took that and actually sat down and worked that into a book consciously, I've done that with two books. Don't ask me why I don't do it with all of them. I like to do things the hard way. I mean, it worked great, because the two books I did that with are the books I've had the best response from readers, from reviewers, from anybody that's read it. I've had the most feedback on those two books. So, and the best sales on those two books. So consciously think about putting in these elements we're talking about, and it can be really worthwhile. K.M. Whelan, who is an author who has a blog as well, she says to think of subtext as Hemingway's 9/10 of the iceberg being underwater. That's your subtext. And the 1/10 that's up above the water is the context, the story, the basic storyline. So even though the reader doesn't see that part of the iceberg under the water, you need, as the author, to dive down there and get familiar with it and know it, so it can hold up that part that's above the water. Okay, another thing you want to do is to add subtext is to make the context, the surface plot, make it plausible and accessible to the reader. And by that I mean, don't make it confusing, but just the basic plot. Otherwise, your reader's going to spend their time trying to figure out what's going on with that part of it instead of reasoning out the subplot. And so, you know, in The Sixth Sense, if he hadn't been dead, it still would have been, you know, a good story if he had been a living psychologist, okay? And that surface plot made sense. If he had been shot and then months later he was well and he got this patient who was a young man, a young boy who had a lot of the same issues that the young man had had that shot him, and he wants to prove to himself that I can help this boy when I didn't help the other one. That would still be a good story, and that makes sense. So readers or watchers of viewers of that movie didn't have to figure out that part of it. You know, you can just pick the clues up for the subtext and reason that out. So make sure it makes sense to the reader, the surface plot, and that it's accessible. This one is my favorite way to do subtext, is to use metaphor, symbolism, and imagery to provide hidden meaning. For instance, you can do that consciously, but sometimes it happens unconsciously. I had written, gosh, maybe four novels before I realized that they have a similar thing going on. Some subtext in all four novels that I didn't consciously put in there for them to be the same, but a lot of my characters in my early romantic comedies wore masks or disguise. They couldn't be seen. For instance, in my first book, Body and Soul, an older woman, older at the time, I wrote this a long time ago, I thought older was 45, you know, so she was in her 40s and married and had a family, and a young girl who was in college, their soul switched bodies, like Freaky Friday kind of a thing, and so the young woman worked for the husband, of the older woman, and the husband starts falling in love with the who he thinks is the young girl that works for him, but he's actually falling in love with his wife, who's in her body. Okay, so he's not really seeing her exterior. He's falling in love with who she is as a person. In my next book, a couple lives next door to each other. They're not friends. They don't like each other, but they're having the same dreams. And in the dreams, he wears like a Zorro mask. I wrote romantic comedy, okay? He is Johnny Amigo, and he wears a Zorro mask.
It's a great name.
And she's in a costume, and so they don't recognize each other, but they fall in love through their dreams. So, you know, similar theme of that first one. He's falling in love with not the real, you know, he hates the real person he thinks. He hasn't gotten to know her or her, him. But in their dreams, when they're in disguise, they fall in love. Then I had a novella, which took place on an island, and a couple, the island has a blackout. This actually happened to me, the part about the blackout, not the rest of this. She is skinny dipping in the ocean, and the island blacks out, and this man rescues her. And they can't see each other, and there's an attraction even though they can't see each other. And she has her clothes on by this point, so that's not the attraction. But so again, I have the same subtext in there of, you know, we're not this, we're what's inside. So I hate to get mushy on you guys, but this was like showing up in all my early books. So you can do that purposely, or sometimes it just happens, you know. You have a theme that maybe resonates with you and it starts showing up as subtext in your stories. I think that those books also had another subtext, which was just these were characters who were hiding a part of themselves. They weren't willing to share, you know, certain parts of themselves. And so through falling in love, they, you know, learned to do that. So in another one of my books, Through Her Eyes, which is a young adult novel, that's a story of a girl who is moves to a little bitty town with her mother and her grandfather, and they move into this old house, and she finds a poetry notebook that a boy that lived there back in the 1930s had written the poems, she thinks, and he is now haunting that house, and she, of course, doesn't know that, but she's reading his poetry journal every night, and she starts hearing this nightingale outside her window every time she reads his poems. Well, it's like almost annoying how loud the nightingale is, and so she does some research on that and finds out that there are no nightingales in North America. So she happens to stumble upon a Percy Shelley poem, and it goes like this. A poet is a nightingale who sits in darkness and sings to cheer its own solitude with sweet sounds. His auditors are as men entranced by the melody of an unseen musician who feel that they are moved and softened, yet know not whence or why. Okay, so I purposely, of course, put this in here. The nightingale represented Henry, the ghost, and his loneliness. And Tansy, my teenage girl protagonist, was the auditor who softened by his song or his poetry. So that symbolic subtext gave the reader a glimpse into her subconscious, what's going on with her, and it also gave the reader a glimpse into the ghost, you know, into his subconscious. He's been haunting this house since the 1930s, and he's trying to get through to somebody. And finally, this girl is starting to kind of pick up on the fact that he's there. So you can also use metaphor to provide hidden meaning. In the Robert Frost poem that reads, "The woods are lovely, dark and deep, but I have promises to keep and miles to go before I sleep." Okay, many people, probably most, think that that is just about a country doctor. You know, he's on his horse, or I can't remember if he's in a buggy and a horse or what, but there's a horse. And he's done late rounds, and he stops in the woods to admire the snowfall and the Woods, but there are some people who think that Robert Frost was using a metaphor there, that the lovely dark and deep is suicide, that he's there contemplating suicide, and then he doesn't succumb to it because he has promises to keep and miles to go before he sleeps, before he dies. So you can purposely, you know, put metaphor in there that has some hidden meaning. Conceal to reveal, another way. And we've talked about that a little. Use blank spots, gaps, and hidden elements to allude to an event without showing it. This causes the reader to speculate about its importance. For instance, if a character refuses to discuss a topic or avoids it. Author K.M. Weiland says that subtext, I love this, subtext exists in the silent spaces. So don't allow your characters to tell each other exactly what they're thinking all the time. She says, whenever you find your character spelling out plainly what they're thinking, take a step back. Ask if this information is absolutely crucial to the advancement of the plot or the reader's understanding of what's going on. If it's not, axe it. Or if it is, see if, you know, if it wouldn't be better if you said it, had the characters say the dialogue, talking around what he's actually trying to say, or say it metaphorically. For example, of the silence and the gaps and concealing to reveal in The Giver, after Joan is chosen to be the new receiver of memories for his community, the chief elder and the current receiver tell him that there will be pain that goes along with his new position. And I'm gonna read it, it's kind of a short little piece, and see if you can't pinpoint the subtext that conceals to reveal something to you as the reader. So the giver has given Jonas already the memory of snow. They don't have snow in the community he lives in, and so he didn't know snow, and he doesn't even know cold, because everything's kept controlled, you know, it's for comfort. Everybody, there's no discomfort. So he's had the snow memory, and now he's gonna get another one. Lie quietly now, said the giver. Since we've entered into the topic of climate, let me give you something else. And this time, I'm not gonna tell you the name of it, because I want to test the receiver. You should be able to perceive the name without being told. I gave away snow and sled and downhill and runners by telling you them to you in advance. Without being instructed, Jonas closed his eyes again. He felt the hands on his back again. He waited. Now it came more quickly, the feelings. This time, the hands didn't become cold, but instead began to feel warm on his body. They moistened a little. The warmth spread, extending across his shoulders, up his neck, onto the side of his face. He could feel it through his clothed parts, too, a pleasant all-over sensation. And when he licked his lips this time, the air was hot and heavy. He didn't move. There was no sled. His posture didn't change. He was simply alone someplace out of doors, lying down, and the warmth came from far above. It was not as exciting as the ride through the snowy air, but it was pleasurable and comforting. Suddenly, he perceived the word for it, sunshine. He perceived that it came from the sky. Then it ended. Sunshine, he said aloud, opening his eyes. Good, you did get the word, said the giver. That makes my job easier, not so much explaining. And it came from the sky, said Jonas. That's right, the old man said, just the way it used to. Before saying this, said Jonas, before climate control. The man laughed. You receive well and learn quickly. I'm very pleased with you. That's enough for today, I think. We're off to a good start. There was a question bothering Jonas. Sir, he said, the chief elder told me, she told everyone, and you told me too, that it would be painful. So I was a little scared, but it didn't hurt at all. I really enjoyed it. He looked quizzically at the old man. The man sighed. I started you with memories of pleasure. My previous failure gave me the wisdom to do that. He took a few deep breaths. Jonas, he said, it will be painful, but it need not be painful yet. I'm brave, I really am. Jonas sat up a little straighter. The old man looked at him for a moment and smiled. I can see that, he said. Well, since you asked the question, I think I have enough energy for one more transmission. Lie down once more. This will be the last today. Jonas obeyed cheerfully. He closed his eyes, waiting, and felt the hands again. Then he felt the warmth again, the sunshine again, coming from the sky of his other consciousness that was so new to him. This time, as he lay basking in the wonderful warmth, he felt the passage of time. His real self was aware that it was only a minute or two, but his other memory-receiving self felt hours pass in the sun. His skin began to sting. Restlessly, he moved one arm, bending it, and felt a sharp pain in the crease of his inner arm at the elbow. "Ouch," he said loudly, and shifted on the bed. "Ow," he said, wincing at the shift, and even moving his mouth to speak made his face hurt. He knew there was a word, but the pain kept him from grasping it. Then it ended. He opened his eyes, wincing with the discomfort. "It hurt," he told the man, "and I couldn't get the word for it. It was a sunburn," the old man told him. "It hurt a lot," Jonas said, "but I'm glad you gave it to me. It was interesting, and now I understand better what it meant, that there would be pain." The man didn't respond. He sat silently for several long seconds. Finally, he said, "Get up now. It's time for you to go home." They both walked to the center of the room. Jonas put his tunic back on. "Goodbye, sir," he said. "Thank you for my first day." The old man nodded to him. He looked drained and a little sad. Okay. Did you get the subtext of that at all? When Jonas said that there was pain and he now understood what they meant when they said he was going to have pain and the old man was silent? You might have to read the whole book to get this, but to me that he's thinking, you know, he's silent because he doesn't want to tell Jonas that there's going to be a different kind of pain that's way worse than a sunburn. So silence can be the, you know, the best, can say more than words and can be the best subtext that you use. Let subtext arise from context. And this is somewhat related to conceal to reveal, and also to make the context sensible and accessible. Author K.M. Weiland says that subtext lives between two known fixed points. Okay, so you tell the reader what they need to know for the surface plot, and that might be, you know, there's points throughout where you're telling them that, but between the points, you don't always want to explain that, okay? For instance, in The Sixth Sense again, that part, you know, where it ends, the screen fades to black, the man's shot, and then the screen fades to black, and then it opens up again months later with him seeing a new patient, the little boy. That subtext in between is what you want, what arises from the context. And although we, most of us that saw that movie got that wrong, except I didn't, the authors or writers of the show really wanted you to get that wrong, so it worked. So point A and point B, those are your two known things that you have to explain to the reader, but let the subtext arise from those. They know this and they know this, so they reason out that, he survived his gunshot, and you know, now he's wanting to help this boy and see if he can't help him better than he did the man. Another example of that would be the Terminator movies. Did everybody see Terminator 1 and 2? Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, that, you know, that's a sequel. And so really that's, you know, kind of one story that's divided in two parts. So if you take that together, you could have, you know, say point A is at the end of Terminator 1, when you see Sarah Connor, she's pregnant, she's driving off alone into the desert after finding out that, you know, in the future, machines are going to come and attack, and her son's going to be the, what's the word for it? He's going to be head up the resistance. And so you see her driving off, and she's still very feminine and, you know, pregnant, and then that's point A. Point B, you see the next Terminator 2 opens up, and she's this tough-as-nails warrior woman and is in a psych ward and has a juvenile delinquent teenage son that we meet. And so that what's in between that point A and point B, we aren't really told what happened, at least not right away, but we viewers start to surmise what happened because we know what happened here and what happened here. And so that makes us able to reason out what happened in between. So let your readers reason that out. And in conjunction with that comes resist the urge to explain. So unless and until you're at a point in your story where you're ready to advance the plot by revealing a secret or a clue or some information that was subtext, keep it subtext. Resist the urge to explain everything until you reach a point where it's necessary. For instance, like at the end of The Sixth Sense, you know, by the end of the movie, at the very end of the movie is when the subtext becomes text, okay, where it comes up and you find out he's dead. So trust your readers to be able to figure that out. Hayden Wieland points out that this is especially true of dialogue, and she advises whenever you find a character saying exactly what he means, stop and question whether you're spoon-feeding readers information that would be more powerful if it remained under your story's surface. It's often better to have them talk around things, or metaphorically. And that's kind of goes back to the giver, that moment of silence when Jonas says, now I know what pain is. Now I understand what you were talking about, and he is silent, like he's, and that's also showing his inner conflict of, you know, do I tell this kid the truth, or do I just continue to do what I'm supposed to do, and give him these memories and let him find out for himself, okay? Avoid presenting characters and situations for exactly what they are, and that's similar to contrasting perception and reality, like we talked about before with Jonas's father. You don't want to always present your characters exactly as they are. And that in The Giver, they present him as he's a very gentle man, he's very kind with his children. He loves babies. He's a nurturer. They gave him that role because he loves babies. But then you find out there's this other part of him that is able to do what, you know, that role requires that's horrible. So sometimes that contrast in a person is very interesting in a character. Okay. You can also use setting as subtext. Most writers don't. I mean, you see it a lot in literary novels where they will use setting as subtext, but it can be really powerful to use it. In a Writer's Digest article, author Mary Buckham gives the following ways to amp up tension and get across an underlying message using setting as subtext. She says, show underlying emotion, a character's feeling through the setting, and you can foreshadow a complication or a conflict through the setting. And let's see if I got this bit. This is kind of a literary mystery, I guess you would call it. Bent Road by Lori Roy. I think it won an Edgar a few years back. But she's really good at using setting to show, using setting as subtext. That I'm going to read you just a very, very short. First, I'm going to read you to give you a little background that you need to know before I read the scene. This is the blurb on the front part of it. For 20 years, Celia Scott has watched her husband Arthur hide from the secrets surrounding his sister Eve's death. As a young man, Arthur fled his small Kansas hometown, moved to Detroit, married Celia, and never looked back. But when the 1967 riots frightened him even more than his past, he convinces Celia to pack up their family and return to the road he grew up on, Bent Road, and the same small town where Eve mysteriously died. While Arthur and their oldest daughter slip easily into rural life, Celia and the two younger children struggle to fit in. Okay. So that's a little background. And then here is the scenes. They've lived in Kansas for a little while. And so this is Celia. Standing at her own kitchen sink, Celia pushes aside the yellow gingham curtains and white shears and takes in her first icy breath since moving to Kansas 2 months earlier. Outside the window, the waxy leaves of a silver maple filter quiet rain. The leaves flutter in the gentle breeze, their silvery white underside sparkling beneath the gray sky. Even on the hottest August nights, the tree had cast a cool, heavy shadow over the kitchen, but the sprinkling of golden leaves among the green reminds Celia that soon the tree will be bare. Okay? It takes a little stretch, but I think, does anybody think they pick up on some subtext there?
I'm just wondering, what was the name of the book again in the author?
It's Bent Road. Laurie, L-O-R-I, Roy, R-O-Y. Her husband moved there with secrets. And to me, the tree casting a heavy shadow over the house was, you know, the heavy shadow of his secret hanging over their family and the house. And but she sees that the leaves are turning and soon the tree will be bare, you know, the shadow will be lifted. So to me, that said his secrets are going to be laid bare for everyone to her, especially to see. So this is a really good book you might check out. Okay. Any questions about all that? I don't know how much time I have. 10 minutes. If any of y'all want to do this, practice, or if you want to take it home, that will take 15 minutes to choose one of the lines below or make up one of your own and work it into two different short dialogue exchanges, each with a different subtext. So, can you spare some change? I'll go for a swim, thanks. It wasn't like that before. If you get stuck, here's a tip. Imagine the line in different genres. Any line spoken in the context of a horror story will likely have a much different meaning than when spoken in a romance. Okay? So, we don't have a whole lot of time to do that, so we might just end a little early. Does anybody have any questions? Or does anybody want to do this in the green years? It's kind of a tough assignment. So, I'm going to see if this is going to work. I have one more slide. It might not work.
It looks... Maybe give it a second. I don't know.
We'll see if we can make it work.
Your baby doesn't love you anymore.
Thank you.
I guess I do have one announcement.
All right, perfect.
We have one more rewrite, repeat, reread, reread t-shirt that we are presenting to our
guests. Oh, there you go.
And with that, everybody, please remember the next anthology. Get your short stories submitted. We're going to have a lot of fun. Those who bought your anthologies, if you want to hang around and get signatures, visit, network. Anything else from anybody? Critique groups. Does anybody want to meet today for critique? Anyone? Oh, well, we don't have to worry about it. Board members, hang around. We got a meeting. Rest of you.
Yeah.